You know, the great Mahatma Gandhi, often referred to as Rajaji, as his conscience keeper. And Rajaji always referred to Dr. Mathuram Santosham as his conscience keeper. And we have with us, very fortunately, the grandson of Mahatma Gandhi and Rajaji, Shri Gopalkrishna Gandhi. Amongst all his other things, he was a High Commissioner of India to South Africa. He was Secretary to the President of India. He was High Commissioner of India to Sri Lanka, Ambassador of India to Norway and Iceland. He was the Governor of West Bengal. And he held additional charge of being Governor of Bihar, and now he's the Chairman of Kalakshetra. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Gopalkrishna Gandhi.
Esteemed Governor, Dr. Rosaiah, Dr. Hande, Shri Murugan, the author of the book being released today, Shri Shriram, members of Dr. Santosham's family, ladies and gentlemen. Not everyone who thinks becomes a thinker. And not everyone who writes can be called a writer. But every single person who acts courageously can be called a man of courage or a woman of courage. But alas, not very many act courageously. Their numbers in any age, the numbers of the courageous in any age, have been smaller than the numbers of the uncourageous. In the last century also, the surface density of those who acted courageously was not higher than that of those who chose silence and caution. But it was certainly higher than what it is today. And even by the high standards of his time, Dr. Santosham was a man of phenomenal courage. By today's standards, he may be described as a man of the most extraordinary and exceptional courage. Yesterday's floor has become today's ceiling. In what exactly did Dr. Santosham's courage lie? Did it lie in his joining an opposition party, irking the ire of the party in power? To an extent, yes, that was an act of courage. Did it lie in his risking his community's displeasure because the great and indomitable Kamaraj was hailed by his kinsmen as their greatest leader? Yes, that was a singularly courageous thing to have done. Did it lie in Dr. Santosham's jeopardizing his medical practice and therefore placing his financial security in uncertainty? Most certainly, yes. But beyond all this, beyond these factors of courage, there was another ground for his being called a man of courage. Dr. Santosham joined the Swatantra Party at a time when there was not a hope in heaven for that party to dislodge the Congress and gain political power. He threw his hat not into the ring of combat, much less of the possibility of success. He threw his hat into the ring of sacrifice. He did what he did, not because he felt he would succeed, but because no matter the costs, he felt it was the right, the ethical and the moral thing to do. That is what made Dr. Santosham a man of courage. When most politicians were counting their prospects on the abacus of smart moves, Dr. Santosham was keeping step with the dictates of his conscience. There were other dimensions to Dr. Santosham's courage. He offered to Rajaji his intellectual comradeship, his political solidarity, his hard work and his time. But he did not offer to Rajaji or to anyone else his blind adherence, his abject loyalty or his bonded duty. Dr. Santosham was an adherent of Rajaji, an admirer of Professor Ranga, an associate of Mr. Meenu Masani, of Professor M. Ratnaswamy, but he was nobody's acolyte. He was a colleague, not a crony. He was himself. We have heard from Dr. Hande a most evocative recounting of those times, and from Mr. Murugan a most touching recounting of those times. I was very young when the Swatantra Party was born, but I was curious enough to see how it functioned and was able to notice with admiration that although Rajaji was the towering founder leader of the Swatantra Party, and though his associates respected him, no one made a god of Rajaji. His colleagues expressed themselves frankly before him, often persuading him to their view. Much of the atmosphere of the pre-independence Congress Working Committee prevailed in the policy-making echelons of the Swatantra Party. This enabled strong and independent-minded persons like Dr. Santosham to find working in that party both possible and pleasant. It is natural for any politician to seek a voice within the party, to seek a position of influence within the party. And during its brief life, the Swatantra Party did make many party workers who were not amongst its senior galaxy to feel that they also mattered nevertheless. Not everyone was an unquestioned leader, but not one was an unquestioning follower. Dr. Santosham's personal prestige owed not a little to the fact that he was a professional, a medical doctor of eminence. India's public life, and the Congress in particular, as we know, had a tradition of lawyers in its ranks. Teachers were another category of prominence, but so were medical practitioners such as the late Dr. M.A. Ansari, Dr. B.C. Roy, Dr. T.S.S. Rajan, Dr. Jeevaraj Mehta, and in the next generation, Dr. Sushila Nair, Dr. Soundaram Ramachandran, and Dr. H.V. Hande. This was a strength-giving factor as it connected the non-political middle class to the struggle. That section of society is able to view national and regional trends with the dispassion of the politically aware as distinct from the politically involved. Neither exploiting nor exploited in some flagrant manner, this professional segment of the population, the middle class, is capable of acting as a ballast to the ship of any political venture. Dr. Santosham represented that seam of our national life in the first non-socialist democratic opposition party in India. It is my belief, and I could be wrong, that one of the reasons for the Swatantra Party's disappearance from India's political life was its inability to interest India's professional and urban middle class. Its dependence on the rural landed aristocracy and the metropolitan capitalist circles painted its future into a shrinking corner of India's political checkerboard. And by the time India's professional and corporate circles began to assert themselves some 3 or 4 decades later, there was no Swatantra Party to play the role of host or patron, the Congress, ironically, doing that with almost seamless ease. And so, what could have been and should have happened logically and ideologically with Swatantra offering a platform to India's middle-class aspirations came about opportunistically with corporate India forging strategic and tactical understandings with parties of all hues from the left to the right. And India's middle class, far from becoming a socio-political choreographer of policy, has ended up as a techno-commercial agent for corporate India. The middle ground has all but disappeared from Indian politics, and the alternatives are a neoliberal India with a globalized order with security-related interdependencies on the one hand and insurgencies of the Maoist variety on the other. Almost every party, including regional parties, and especially those in office, have to take their place and be counted within this polarization. The victim is the honest-to-goodness Democrat. Almost all of us representing that honest-to-goodness Democrat, who wants India, first of all, to be well-governed, more or less free of monopolistic, exploitative, and corrupt practices, offering to its citizens at least two choices of alternative parties, with one being a hard-working party in office and the other being an equally hard-working and alert opposition. In that vacated space, for which Swatantra's own myopia must take part of the blame, the good politician of Dr. Santosham's kind has also moved out of the stage. Politics is now only a gradient for office. Office is a ramp to power, and power an opera with money playing a multi-organ orchestra. Dr. Santosham was a good man in politics. Of how many can that be said today? Dr. Santosham was a strong man in politics. Of how many who are not at the helm can that be said today? Would Dr. Santosham have survived in Indian politics today, in 2013? That is like asking, would C.K. Naidu, Vijay Merchant, and Mushtaq Ali survive in Indian cricket today? The answer, of course, is no. But we should turn this thing on its head and say that politics ultimately cannot survive without good men and women who are strong, or strong men and women who are good. Something called politics will survive, but it will not be a politics that is respected and admired. It will be a politics that is bemoaned for being what it is, suffered in contempt, and watched like a cricket match we know has been spot fixed, not because we like it, but for the only reason that it is there.